1033 The GOAT.
Yeah, that's the one.
K277DQ Lafayette, 1420 KPEL Lafayette. Thirsty for intelligent sports talk? Sounds like you need a little Gatorade. 1033 The GOAT. The greatest sports talk of all time.
Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by the Great Scott Show, the champion.
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Welcome in to a Gimme All You Got edition of the Great Scott Show on this Friday. It's 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. Hope everybody is doing well out there. A lot of football last night in high school, pro game. Tom Brady's experiencing firsts in his career on the wrong end of them. But the Cajuns played last night. In a state where, frankly, they have not had very much success. I mean, that might be an understatement. At a venue where they've only won one time, The Rock. In a game that you got behind the eight ball so much early and you weren't able to overcome it. You kept clawing back. You kept fighting. But you kept making the crucial mistake. Now, I was way off. I thought Southern Miss would score 14 points. That was my prediction. They ended up having more than that in the first quarter. Before you looked, it was 20-2. But the reality is this. When you get off to a slow start, when you are 0-for-5 on fourth down, when you lose the turnover battle by two and have three interceptions and a fumble, when you miss field goals, when you don't convert in the red zone, when you give up safeties, all of the major, major stuff. Because you can look at total yards. Oh, look at that. They outgained Southern Miss by 100. See, Louisiana made the adjustments at halftime, which allowed them to still be in the game with 2 minutes left. One possession game. There they are. They got the ball. No timeouts, but they got a shot. But they dug themselves far too big of a hole. Far too big of a hole. I mean, at one point, they were being outgained by Southern Miss by 200 yards, and they ended up outgaining the Golden Eagles by over 100. You could talk about cosmetic yards and late game. Yeah, you know, it wasn't like Southern Miss was just playing nonstop prevent on the last few Cajun drives. I mean, they were rushing 5-6 at times on that last one, which led to a pick. The big thing was the defense, struggling with the Wildcat in the first half, giving up big plays, something you haven't seen them do this year until you saw them do it last night. They made adjustments at halftime. They came out. Southern Miss gained 55 yards the entire second half. That's it. And yet Louisiana headed back to Lafayette on the bus from Hattiesburg with a 15-point loss. It was a pick six at the end when the Cajuns were trying to go down and possibly send the game to overtime. It was 4th and 14. Heave it up there. And Coach Desimo afterwards, he continued to put the onus on himself, on the coaches, saying, look, I got to readjust, got to reevaluate how we did things. I thought we were ready to play, but based on the start we had tonight, clearly we weren't. And they weren't. Let's be real. Southern Miss came out and punched them in the face a couple of times. Hard punches. And yes, I'm not even saying this like something should be said for not giving in and continuing to claw and fight back when you're down by as much as you are on the road and making it a game. Absolutely. Of all the things that went wrong, I mean, the fact that they even had a shot with the ball in there, with possession, down 8 in the final 2 minutes of the game was crazy, considering all the things that went wrong. I mean, when they didn't get the 4th and goal, and then one play later, Zion Hill-Green strips Frank Gore Jr., it's like, this team really doesn't quit. And that is a good trait. That is a notable trait. But it's nice to not have the quit in you whenever you're winning and you're on the right side of the scoreboard, something they never were last night. Never led. Down early. I mean, that's the 10th straight win for the Golden Eagles against the Cajuns. And, yeah, I like the idea that these teams are now in a conference together and in the same division together. But you know what? Talk about rebooting a rivalry. You're going to need to win some games against the Golden Eagles to make it a rivalry. Frank Gore Jr. rushed for 87 yards. He threw for a touchdown. It looked like it was going to be a lot more than that after the start. But again, they bottled it up. But the Wildcat, they first half, you know, were they ready for it? Chris Moncrief, Razor Cage linebacker, said, look, it's just about discipline, man. We just had to be more disciplined, and we weren't. And we got to be ready from the start. Zion Hill-Green says a little bit, but they were able to adjust. But by the time they adjusted, they were down. They were playing catch-up. Ben Waldrich was throwing the ball a lot. The protection wasn't as good last night as it had been the previous few weeks, but the opponent was really good. We talked about Southern Miss's defense. And on the other side of it, you had a quarterback in Wilkie that has turned the ball over a lot this year, and he didn't do that last night. He threw one pick. I say he didn't do it. He threw one pick, and he did it right out of the gate. And you're thinking, boy, this start can't get any better. And then suddenly it couldn't get any worse. Do you know the Cajuns were 0 of 5 on 4th downs last night? In the entire season, Southern Miss, who was 8 games into the season, opponents going for it on 4th down against Southern Miss the whole season are 2 of 16. 2 of 16. They just don't give up 4th downs. That's a credit to them. They played really well. Some bright spots for Louisiana. Coming back, making it a game. Michael Jefferson, he's got so much pro potential. 6 catches, 179 yards. Neil Johnson, that hurdle, what a highlight. It's 250-pound tight end. I don't know what his vertical is, but you could definitely jump over me. You had a lot of different players catch a pass. You clawed, you fought your way back in, but turnovers are, without question, the quickest way to kill any momentum you have, especially if you're playing catch-up. And that's true in football, and that's true in basketball, and it's just a fact. It is. It's the quickest way to do it. Disappointing, to say the least, for Louisiana last night. They fall to 4-4, and in my opinion, while maybe it's not mathematically done, they are off of the table as far as getting to a Sun Belt Conference championship game. And they've been in every single one of them out of the West Division since the game came to be. You've had that extra game in December every year since they came up with the Sun Belt Conference championship game. That's not going to happen this year. And if it does, I'll gladly be like, you know what? Didn't see that coming. I was wrong. But the amount of things that would need to happen now, you're 2-3. Oh, you're only 2 games back and you play Troy, but you've lost to South Alabama. You've lost to Southern Miss. They have a 2-game edge on you. Southern Miss has a 2.5-game lead on you. That's done. Now, I know, you know, now you focus on Troy. You try to win. Then you got Georgia Southern on a short week. You have Florida State and Texas State to end the season. You're trying to get bowl eligible. You're trying to get better. You're trying to play. You still have things to play for. But as far as how the season had played out, that was a huge game last night. A huge game. And the big mistakes, four turnovers, 0 of 5 on fourth down, special teams issues, whether it be a missed kick, whether it be a kick out of bounds, whether it be, you know. I mean, there were some weird games. There were some weird plays in that game last night. The Cajuns returned the first PAT back for 2 points. Trey Amos outrunning everybody. Then they almost gave up two on their own PAT, two-point try, rather, when Woldridge threw a pick and he chased down the Southern Miss defender. Good for him. A lot of hustle there. Then that ball's on the ground. You're like, is Jefferson about to, or John Stevens about to pick this up and run the other way? It was just weird. And then there was a safety and intentional grounding safety, which you knew as soon as he threw it. I was surprised it took the refs as long as it did to throw the flag. Lots of odd plays. But Cajuns now get a little bit of extra rest before they take on Troy, who right now is in the driver's seat to represent the Sun Belt West in the conference championship game. But Cajuns could throw a big wrench into that. Because if the Cajuns beat them, then Southern Miss is like, hey, you might have beat us by 17, but now we're in the driver's seat. You know who graduated from Southern Miss? My next guest, our Saints and Pelicans correspondent, Gus Kattengell, who joins me every single Friday and has on this show for 15 years now. Gus will join me in a minute. We'll talk about last night's game, hit on the Saints, a little bit on the Pelicans, and then we're going to let him go. It'll be a shorter Pro Nola segment than normal. Chris Lanaux, UL analyst, former Raging Cajun defensive end. He'll join us at 8 to break down the game a little bit. We're going to talk World Series as well. It starts tonight, Astros, Phillies. Got a lot to get into on this. Give me all you got Friday. Well, you can tell I'm losing my voice. That was rough.
Give me all you got! Give me all you got!
I should just leave it to Al. With the GOAT in the background, by the way. This is 103.3 The GOAT. Greatest sports talk of all time. Simulcast on 1420. Back in 2 minutes with Gus Kattengell on The Great Scott Show.
Give me all you got! Give me all you got!
Download the free 103.3 The GOAT app now. You've got mail and the very latest sports news now.
Did he say what I think he said?
103.3 The GOAT.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday. Saints take it on the Raiders Sunday. Pelicans in action tonight and Sunday. Who will be available? Who won't? We know a few that won't. Many are TBD. The World Series starts tonight, but more than all that, we're going to open up our conversation with our Saints and Pelicans correspondent, Gus Kattengell, about last night's game that I've been talking about since the start of the show, Louisiana and Southern Miss. Gus Kattengell, a Southern Miss grad. You know, Gus, these teams used to play each other all the time back in the day. The Golden Eagles often got the better end of it. I feel like it's a good natural rivalry to reboot. I think it's great, but maybe we shouldn't call it a rivalry because Southern Miss, frankly, is kind of owned the Cajuns, if we're being real, you know?
I don't know about all that just yet, man. On Tuesdays I have both coaches on, and Coach Dez at 12:45 and Coach Hall at 12:15, and it was crazy to hear how both of them spoke about one another because they coached, you know, on the same staff in 2017. And I think the thing that really stood out to me, man, in hearing from both, obviously, is, you know, the programs are in different spots, man. Like, and I'm just being honest. Look, I have buddies that are still season ticket holders and get out there and, you know, if you could look at if I screenshotted you my text messages of the game, you know, it's a win, but it's crazy to think of, I guess what Will had to do, you know, while you guys were winning championships and going to conference games, you know, I mean, you know, obviously, because you follow and stuff. I mean,
they were barely winning. Yeah, they weren't winning games.
I mean,
historically, so, Southern Miss has just won a lot more. 100%. That's all I'm talking about. I mean, That's it. I love the fact that they're going to play again next year, and after that, I agree. They're in the same division. It's going to be good. It's going to be good across all sports. Last night's game was just chock full of weird plays. You know, the Cajuns put themselves behind the eight ball so much, and then in the second—I mean, Southern Miss had 51 yards in the second half.
Like, it's a high school offense. I've never seen anything like it. Scott, I'm watching that, and I'm going, if the Saints could have that kind of defense, because that's clearly a team right now that's winning games because of one side of the football. I mean, the offensive output—I mean, that you see, like you saw against Tulane. And last week where you saw the one big pass play, but that's it, man. I mean, you know, what was it, 3 minutes left after you guys scored a touchdown? I mean, Southern Miss literally ran the ball three straight times to run clock, and they got 1 yard. They weren't even trying to get a first down. They had no confidence in throwing the football. It's just crazy when you think about it. I mean, it's what Will Hall has to do right now, man. But, yeesh, I would love the Saints to have that kind of defense, huh?
Yeah, I mean, they've forced turnovers this year. They've been good. I would have, you know, they're opportunistic. I mean, I would. There's no way you could have convinced me when the Cajuns were down by as much as they were and being outgained by over 200 yards that they would end the game with more than 100 yards than Southern Miss. But that was more about the Eagles' offense in the second half and the Cajuns adjusting to it and doing things, but. You know, you get out. Look, I know it's different, college pro. I get all that, but when you dig yourself such a big hole, it's awfully hard to come out of it. Now, you know, we saw the Saints do it 8 days ago. You throw two pick sixes, forget about it. You know, the Cajuns were 0-5 on fourth down. They had four turnovers. They had some special teams issues. You do all of that. It's really difficult to win, and yet. There they were with the ball with 2 minutes and 5 seconds left and only down by eight with a chance to still be in the game. It was the game just felt weird in a lot of ways because it felt like such extremes, like different moments. Like it's so extreme for this team. Now it's so extreme for that team, but when you're just watching the game in the moment, you're just kind of following the score. But just the way it all played out was very, very, very odd last night.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, look, to your point, I'm looking at the clock, you know, I'm texting two guys that are at the game and they were saying the same things, like, this clock can't go fast enough. I mean, like, when you think about what you just said, too, where you've had the defensive performance you had, the turnover battle that you've won, and I would tell you, and even judging, and you saw it by the looks on the TV, right, by those there, that I don't think anybody was confident that they were going to win there. So, I mean, that's crazy when you think about it. Yeah, just find a way to win when you had that kind of a lead and you were in that kind of control on defense. But that's, you know, that's Southern Miss in a nutshell. You just saw it, you know, last night.
Gus Kattengell, our guest, 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420. We'll get back to some Cajun football later. Chris Lano is going to join us at 8 to break it down. Saints and Pelicans correspondent Gus Kattengell, our guest. All right, we're going to move on to the black and gold for a minute. Andy Dalton getting the nod over Jameis. I was a little surprised. A lot of people weren't, only because, you know, I've been saying on your show and on this one, I felt like once Jameis was fully healthy enough to where the injury wasn't impacting his throws, that he'd be the guy. Or at least get another shot at it. Not that Dalton's been bad. They've moved the ball. A lot of it's been the run game. I don't know. Maybe I should have seen it coming. And I figured Dennis Allen would just wait this thing out as long as Winston was on the injury report. But came out, said, nope, you know, Dalton's going to be the starter. And you start looking at the numbers. I suppose it makes sense. But before I toss it to you, I'll just tell you what I've been saying for a while. I don't know that whether it's Dalton or Winston is the major, you know, is the major emphasis, you know, and point that's going to help turn the season around for the Saints. I mean, they're in the awful NFC South. They have a chance. All they got to do is win a few games. And yet, whether it's Dalton or Winston, it's the other little things. It's the discipline. It's the effort. It's the tackling. It's all of those are the things that if the Saints want to climb out of this giant hole they've dug, those are the things they've got to fix. It's not going to be as much about who's under center. That's just my opinion on it. But what has the reaction been like on your show in New Orleans to the Dalton Winston thing? And has that debate maybe gotten too much of a run, not enough run? What's your take overall?
I would almost say it's sort of what you were just talking about with the Southern Miss Cajuns game. Like when you kept saying it's just weird. I'd have never thought I'd have spent, 4 days this week, dude, having people say, you know, forget the Saints, I'm a Pel, lock up. I mean, people are, it's like the Titanic, dude. They're jumping shit. What's crazy is this. I said this yesterday to two guests.
Pull their card real quick. Pull their fan card. Take it from all of them. Every one of them that says it. Take it from them.
I think what's crazy is I literally opened up two segments yesterday with national guests saying, I'm just telling you, I never thought I'd be in a situation where you do have the season in front of you. You still have your goals in front of you. You had a chance, you know, that you were looking at that the Ravens could beat the Bucks, and if that's the case, you win Sunday. Panthers beat the Falcons. You have all four teams in first place. Carolina
would hold the tiebreaker.
Right? That's incredible. That's literally incredible. They fired
eight
their
games
coach
into the season.
Rid of McCaffrey.
Oh my
and,
god!
And they would be in first place. But the point is, with all of that, I'm telling you, Scott, I can't find anybody, not the gym, not the grocery store, not my morning dog walks when I run into people that are screaming, hey, we got this Sunday, man. We're going to be in first. There ain't no confidence. I'm telling you, there's no confidence that they're going to go into the Dome Sunday and beat a fellow two-win team that's been penalty-ridden, turnover-ridden.
It's true.
I'm just being honest.
It's true, crazy. Though. You're right. But yeah, you know how no fickle confidence. Fans are. I'm not expecting them to win, for the record.
Yeah.
But for argument's sake, let's say they put together their best, most disciplined, clean game of the season and win by, 9-10 points. You know, every one of them is going to be like, we're hosting a playoff game. Like that's what's going. If they look competent, if they look good on Sunday, I'm not expecting it. If they look good, oh man! If they run the ball and Dalton throws three touchdowns, and oh, you know, Thomas is coming back soon, Gus, and Lattimore will be back, and man, it's all the NFC South is bad. That's going to happen. And if they lose, it's just going to be Armageddon. I mean, you know, that's 2022 right now with not just Saints fans. I mean, that's just the nature of it, brother.
Scott, the last hour of my show is when do you blow it up? And I didn't start it.
How do you blow it up? Considering the contracts they have, I mean, there's some absurd report out there about Kamara's on the trade block. Really, you think the Saints are about to just create $17 million in cap space right now to trade them and all the debt? Like, stop it. But their contracts.
All right, Sean Payton's agent doing that.
Their lack of, their contracts, their lack of a first-round pick, like all these things, it makes it hard. And the fact that the division is just such garbage. And I think Gale and Lauscha, they've kind of shown, and Loomis have shown that it's not really how they operate. Like, I'm going to shut up. Let me throw it to you. What is your definition based on the reality of where the Saints are in terms of cap, contracts, all that? What is your definition of, quote, blowing it up?
Well, again, my definition is different than what obviously these fans want. First off, you have to start with there is a massive belief with this fan base, at least they call my show, at least the people that text me, they are convinced Michael Thomas is not playing on purpose, which is baffling to me. Yeah. I mean, it's baffling to me. Because if the way I look at it is, if he didn't show up to training camp, in shape, play dominant in the one game that we had really seen against the Falcons, score those touchdowns and do like that, man, I might listen to your argument. But that's not the case. And if you don't think turf toe is a serious thing, it's a serious thing. Go Google it. Go look it up. You know, I was talking to somebody yesterday about it. He brought up a very good point. I mean, it ended Deion Sanders' career, you know, a toe injury like that's similar. I mean, I'm not saying that's what Thomas has. I'm just saying a toe injury can, you know, really affect you. It stinks, you know. I mean, you have a guy like him and Jarvis Landry that you thought were going to be on in an offense that were going to help you do certain things, man, and they're not. So I think it starts there because he's the first person everyone brings up. First person, you know. Trade Michael Thomas, and then I respond with him, what are you getting for him? He hasn't played. So you need him to play. He needs to play. If he wants bigger contracts, more money, get into the Hall of Fame, he needs to play. So I don't understand the narrative of he's sitting at home playing Xbox. That's not what he's doing. Well, Cam Jordan, he's terrible. He's father time. He's literally the only pass rusher you have.
Yeah. Everyone's in there.
What are you getting?
Yeah. I mean, Thomas, the idea that Thomas isn't here next year is a strong possibility, but it's going to be because he's released and the dead cap hit won't hit you nearly as bad as it would the following year or right now. It has, you're not going to get draft picks for it. You're not.
No, man. No, Saints fans won 5 first-round picks and all this other stuff for, like, everybody. And that's what I'm getting at, though. What I mean, because when they say blow it up, I'm like, well, what exactly are you blowing up, right? Because I'm not blowing up anything on the offensive line. I mean, that offensive side of the football, like, well, you know, Pete Sting. So I'm like, okay, great. Who are you replacing him with? I mean, it's always easier to say get rid of this guy because we need somebody better, and I will agree with you on some places and some people, but who are you replacing them with? And that's a lot when you don't have a lot of draft capital, where you don't have certain issues to go into it. So, and then it's, you know, it's being realistic. If, look, the safety position has to be redone. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Tyrann Mathieu's not going to be here next year. I have a hard time buying he's a Saint next year. You have to figure out what you're doing with the defensive end positioning. Are you keeping Marcus Davenport?
No, don't
well,
do that.
Well, that's
don't
what I'm getting
that.
At, okay?
Don't do that.
Defensive tackle is an area you've got to draft somehow, some way, or
bingo,
free agency or something. Is Cam here or not? I don't know. He may want to go into the NFL Network, man, and go do with that. But
he wants that same sack
offensive
record, too, doesn't he? He wants that
but
same sack
saying,
record.
Man. Look, on the offensive side, those guys are coming back. You hope that they're healthy. You try to find a quarterback, and, you know, that's young in the draft. Thanks to Sean Payton coming back coaching, which I think is going to happen. He can parlay, move that up, get a guy in the late mid-first round, pray, whoever it is, Dalton or Jameis starts next year. And then by mid-season, you throw in the rook, I guess. I don't see the blowing up thing. And I understand we had a caller yesterday say, well, great, you go get a young quarterback. Alvin Kamara, by the time he's good, is going to be – I hear you. You're not there yet.
Yeah, you're not
there
you're
yet.
Not,
I mean,
and I think the one thing, Gus, that 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420 is the Great Scott Show. The one thing a lot of these fans you're referencing, and I'm not speaking for every Saints fan, but I think what they need to understand is all the years they love bragging about, you know, Mickey Loomis math and, oh, they're never in cap hell, blah, blah, blah. They're not as long as they're winning. The problem is when you operate the way they have and you run up the credit card, when the contracts become bad and they're not tradable, and then or you have to you know, cut the player earlier because they're just not performing, and then the dead money is a lot big. That's when it catches up with you. It's not, well, they can't sign anybody. Look, if they want to sign someone next offseason and they really, really want them, they've shown they're gonna do it if they want to, you know, and barring a pandemic, you know, and let's all, you know, knock on wood, they're gonna do it. It's moments like this, you know, near the trade deadline's Tuesday where. And you might want to make a move. You might want to acquire something. Well, you can't really get rid of that guy, even if he has value, because look at how much you're giving up anyway, and look at how much it's going to hurt your cap in the short term, and what are you really even getting in return? That's where, you know, this stuff starts to kind of bite you in the butt. But with that, Gus, I know we got a short clock with you this morning, and I don't want to wait and start talking about the Pelicans with like a minute left in the segment. So, Pels, 3-1. Injury list is long. Nothing appears to be serious with the exception of potentially Brandon Ingram. It's basically we have no idea. We know he's not on the road trip. But, you know, the concussion thing's weird. I remember talking to former New Orleans Hornets legend, Jason Smith, one season, you know, when he had been dealing with a concussion, and he ended up being out for a long time. Other guys get it. They're out for a week or two in the NBA. We have no idea. But I want to make a larger point. In the past, it seems like you see Zion in the injury report, and he might play tonight. You see Herb Jones. You see Ingram. You see all this. See CJ. You start thinking, man, here we go again. It's all downhill. And I've been telling folks, it's different this year. Not just because they beat the Mavs the other night, not just because they have depth, but they don't feel like season enders. They don't feel like this, oh my God, you can't withstand this because you're top heavy and have no depth. You've got a team, not because, okay, we don't have any depth and now we got some bench guys and they're going to try to put up their numbers so they can get a future contract. That's not how this team operates. That's not how they think. They're kind of just all in it together. And I don't know what happens tonight in Phoenix. I don't know who's going to be available, but I know this. They're not going to bow down. They're not going to bend over. They're going to fight and claw the entire time. And I just keep telling everybody that wants to listen, it's different this year, brother, because I know we're only four games in, and it's not just based on the first four games. It's based on really the last year. It's just different right now over on Airline Drive at the Pelicans facility.
I agree. I think that's a great way to just kind of overall say what you're feeling there. You do have depth. And, I mean, look, you look at that game on Tuesday, and, I mean, look at last night. I mean, the Mavericks went up to Brooklyn and beat Kyrie and KD, and they both had 30s in their game. So, I mean, when you look at it, it's not like you can't see that they're beating good teams or anything like that. I mean, Dallas is a very good team. I mean, they are. So when you look at that, eight players had double figures, and C.J. McCollum had a terrible shooting night, but still found a way. That Alvarado, before he got injured in that game, was kind of leading the charge in the way that Dyson Daniels, you know, you saw the rookie play so well and make those stops and score. I mean, it's frustrating just on a personal level because, like, Todd and I are texting back and forth yesterday.
Todd Gravanini, the play-by-play man of the Pels.
And he's like, this is unbelievable that this team can't stay healthy. It's like, it's just nuts. But that's, you know, I don't know, man. I don't know if that part, that facility on airline is cursed or what. Scott, I don't understand.
I mean,
it
these injuries are happening in the game, though. You know, it's like...
Yeah, well, some, yeah, just... exactly. And just, it just stinks, dude. But to your point, I would say almost unlike in the NFL where, you know, you don't have as much time to really kind of turn things around, which is probably why a lot of people don't have the confidence, per se, that team, you know, that people used to with the Saints organization. You know, you're still in October, and in the NBA, man, you got time, right? I mean, like, it was funny. I remember talking about it when the season started. Because, I didn't know what kind of season it was going to be. So I almost probably did it, Scott, to kind of just prep Pels fans and just kind of just relax. You know, if they started out slow because of the opponents they were about to play, you know, Dallas is good, Brooklyn is good, this road trip, you know, is pretty good. But you just never know what happens. I mean, look, the Clippers flew back Kawhi Leonard earlier this week back to L.A. to check his knee. You know, he's not doing well, so he may not be available on Sunday. The Lakers... going into, you know, this tonight's game, they still haven't won a game. You know, they're on this road trip. So I think when you put all of that into perspective, you understand it's a long season. And I think that's the thing that stands out to me. Look, if it's going to happen, you have all these injuries, I'd much rather it be now and you're 3-1. I mean, it was November 19th, Scott. last year when they won their third game. So they are definitely ahead of schedule when you look at it from that perspective. But it is just different, man, because I'm going to argue, not even argue, I'm telling you the three wins had nothing to do with Zion. Not that, you know, 25 points and stuff like that didn't help and things of that nature in Charlotte and all that. I'm just saying, like, he hasn't, quote-unquote, taken over the game, dominated the game, been an unstoppable force. He still hasn't knocked down, I think, two jump shots, not taking a three. These are all different things that we've seen elements of him do. CJ, as I mentioned, you know, has had up and down games, more down. The concussion thing is baffling to me. It was a backhand by Najee Marshall, you know, that hit Brandon Ingram in the face. And, you know, to hear Coach Green say yesterday, at least three games, he left that door open for it to be more when they come back.
Which sure. Is, I mean, you know, don't I know. Mean, he's got to clear it all. Like, I remember, I talked to Jason Smith, and he missed – you know, well over a month one season and couldn't even
That's
go
crazy.
Outside
yeah.
because it would, like, the light would yeah. hurt him. He just laid around. Now, yeah. I have no idea. And we'll see what happens tonight. I'm anxious to see, like, you got Zion, Herb Jones, Jose Alvarado, Dyson Daniels, CJ McCollum, all questionable. Do you, yeah. if they're on the fence, do you just sit them all and play, you know, Garrett Temple, good Lord, and Sebron for yeah. because you're, like, not thinking about tonight as much as the bigger picture or the next games on the road trip? I don't know. I think basically Willie's not looking at it that way. Medical staff says, yeah, they're good to go. He's going to play them. And so I'd like to see guys hopefully healthy enough to go tonight. And, you know, New Orleans returning to Phoenix for the first time since last postseason. But ultimately, you want to be healthy the entire season, and you don't want to rush anyone back. And we've seen this medical staff under Aaron Nelson be very judicious, very hesitant to put anyone back out
very
there.
Very cautious. Yeah. I mean, Zion said it yesterday. He's like, it's going to be up to them if I play. I mean, it's crazy.
It was up to him. He'd be out there.
It's not deciding.
Right.
Right. So, you know, that's the way I look at it. But it is different, Scott. I do think you're on to that. Look, it feels different. It looks different. And you have the right places. And again, going back to how weird this week has been, to hear how Saints fans are speaking, man, we wish we had that kind of coach, that kind of team, that kind of dog, that kind of fight, that kind of togetherness in the locker room. And you know, listening to Alvin Kamara on Wednesday talk about, you know, he's having to call out people for going off sides at practice because no one else is.
Dennis Allen is the substitute teacher that shouldn't have gotten the permanent role. Gus Kattengell has been our guest. Follow him on Twitter at GKatt_17 at GKATT_17. Check out the Sports Hangover New Orleans, ESPN 100.3 weekdays, noon to 3. My friend, I appreciate the time. All the best. Be listening to you on the Pelicans post game tonight, and I will talk to you next week.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
You got it. That is Gus Kattengell. We'll take a quick timeout. Come back. Open up phone lines 337-269-1077. World Series. How should you be viewing the Astros heading into this thing? How big is the cheater moniker still following them, even though that was, you know, what, 4 or 5 years ago? What kind of shot do you give the Phillies? Chris Lanaux at 8. Michael Desimo's post-game comments from last night. All of that and more all coming your way this morning on The Great Scott Show. It's a Give Me All You Got Friday, 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
It's a good thing goats have four stomachs. Otherwise, there's no way we could swallow some of these takes.
Hey, goat, what's going on out there?
103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show on a Friday. Give me all you got Friday. Chris Lanaux at 15 minutes.
A lot of high school football last night. A ton of games moved up to Thursday in anticipation of some bad weather tonight. And it may not happen until really late. We'll see. From the Storm Team 3 Weather Lab and Dave Baker. Cloudy today, 70% chance of rain, high of 78. Likely rain tonight, and if it does rain during the game time, it's going to be heavy, so you could have some wet football fields out there, a low of 66. But if you're looking for a rundown of all of the scores from last night, and there were a bunch involving teams in and around the area, and a rundown of the schedule tonight, head over to 1033thegoat.com or the 1033thegoat app. We got your Week 9 high school football scores. And we'll be doing it again tonight. We'll be updating those scores as they unfold. So you definitely want to keep it locked in and follow all the scores that way. But, you know, Ascension Episcopal beat Delcom last night by, I think, 38. Crushed them. Mamou got a win. Barr beat Como. Lutcher beat Morgan City. Acadiana and Carenco played last night in a game that Acadiana's a big win for them. Carenco's feeling like they might have let it slip away with some big turnovers. Acadiana saying, no, we created it. We feel good. Regardless, 21-20 the final. Notre Dame beat Grand Lake by a bunch. St. Martinville beat Abbeville. OC beat Sacred Heart of Ville Platte. St. Edmund beat Westminster. Westminster Lafayette, different one, 137-7 over Montgomery. Gadol fell to Oberlin. Erath beat Crowley by 11. Iota beat Port Barry by a bunch. Lauraville beat Catholic High New Iberia 20-17. Eunice won 38-33 against Leesville. So, you know, that's a rundown of some of the scores from last night. But if you want to get the whole thing and tonight's schedule and keep up with tonight's games as they unfold, as far as the scores go, you know where to find them over at the 1033 The Goat app or 1033thegoat.com. For most of you, though, nowadays it's just that app. So check it out. Northwest beat Ville Platte 6-0 last night. Shout out to them for getting the win. All right. World Series. I am not an Astros fan, and I don't like the Phillies. Therefore, I'm kind of, you know, I suppose I'm rooting for the Phillies. Astros. It's more rooting against the Phillies than it is rooting for the Astros, but call it what you want. You could say, all Scott, it's semantics. So my friends that are Astros fans are like, yep, we knew it. Okay, guys. All right, that's fun. But most of America is rooting against the Astros. I'm sure you guys know that. I mean, their 2017 cheating scandal, it bothered a lot of people. And on top of that, even if you didn't have the cheating scandal, most of America would be rooting against the Astros because they're incredible. The fourth time in 6 years they're in the World Series. And, you know, they're at home, but when they hit the road for game three, you know, there's going to be booing and all that other stuff. Well, you know, they're cheaters. Or are they like the most dominant team of this era? Maybe a little bit of both. I mean, a lot of people said that about the Patriots, right? Not enough people said the former, but they said the latter. We're far enough removed from 2017, guys. That was 5 years ago. Do you see how dominant this team is? And as brazen and dumb as their whole trash can banging and alleged buzzing and all that stuff was, this team is dominating. Dominating. And if you want to boo them and call them asterisks and cheaters, that's fine. But you should also acknowledge that, okay, they deserve that, but they also maybe deserve, you know, some credit for how good they are right now. For constantly playing in October, constantly winning in Major League Baseball for that long of a period of time, it's rare. It's difficult. I mean, the Royals won the World Series in 2015, and they went right back to being one of the worst teams in professional sports after that. It can fall off in a hurry. Don't deny the fact that the Astros, despite the buzzer-wearing conspiracies and the demise of many, have ridiculous power, that Dusty Baker has done an incredible job I mean, they're potentially an all-time great team.
But they need to win the World Series.
You want to be an all-time great team, you want to start to wash a little bit of that stank off. You go out, you beat the Phillies, you handle your business, yeah.
I get it. The Nationals in 2019, the Braves last year, they beat them. Maybe the Phillies will join that list too.
The cheating in 2017 hurts them. It puts some stink on them. But don't let that blind you from the fact that right now they are a baseball powerhouse heading into this World Series. They are. It starts tonight. We've got high school football for you tonight on our airwaves. Livonia at Cecilia. Mike Bernard, they call him the Bandit. He's got it. Northside at Turlings on our sibling station, Newstalk 96.5 KPEL. LCA at North Vermilion. That's on Classic Rock 105.1. Tomorrow we will be airing Georgia versus Florida in college football, and then game two of the World Series. And then next week, game three, game four, if there's a game five, we'll be airing all of that for you. So when there's not a conflict with UL or high school sports, we've got World Series for you right here on 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time. You can email me if you want to get in on the show this morning, Scott at 103.3thegoat.com. You can hit us up on Twitter at 103.3thegoat. That's the Twitter handle. Yes, sir. Doug tweets the show. He says, Scott, outside of the slow start and the turnovers, what do you think the biggest issue was for the Raging Cajuns last night? Fourth down conversions. You could liken them to turnovers in some regards, but I don't. I mean, they're more calculated. You're planning to go for it. You know the risk. You're never planning to just turn the ball over. But 0-5 on force, being aggressive early, it didn't work. Being aggressive throughout, I mean, that's you really needed to be aggressive in the second half to try to get back into it, and they did despite a lot of gas, despite a lot of mistakes, despite not just being able to quite get past that breaking point. But, yeah, it was fourth down. Southern Miss this season, their defense, on fourth downs, opponents have gone 2 of 16 this season against Southern Miss. I mean, they're good. We're going to talk more about that. We'll ask Chris Lano that question. He's going to join us for a segment. Crippa is his nickname. Formerly of the Rage of Cajun Sports Radio Network, color analyst, played the defensive end for Louisiana back in the mid to late 2000s. He is locked in. He's got friends on the staff. He follows this team as close as anybody. He's got some opinions. We'll get into that with him next. After Cripple, we'll have open phone lines. We'll talk about the college football slate this weekend, the NFL, Saints Raiders. We got Coach Michael Desimo post-game audio as well for you. Don't go anywhere. It's the Great Scott Show on it. Give me all you got Friday. 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420. It's the GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Nas in the house with Beastie Boys, we can turn it out. Perpetrators, we can point them out. So if you got something on your mind, let it out.
Like a Nexus 6, coming home to boost. Handheld, 58 when it's time to get loose. Don't need the ear goggles, put me through the speakers like a scientist. With tubes and beakers, have MCs over my house.
Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by the Great Scott Show, the champion.
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Welcome Welcome into the 8 o'clock hour on a Gimme All You Got Friday of the Great Scott Show. We've talked Pels, Saints, high school football, World Series, and we kicked off really the first, I guess, half hour of the show talking UL Southern Miss. We're going to do another segment on that with analyst and Raging Cajun alum Crippa, maybe better known by his birth name of Chris Lanaux, a friend of the program. Good morning, Chris. Happy Friday, my friend. How are you?
Well, you know, what's funny about that, Crippa actually might be my birth name because that's when the nickname was originated.
I love how you have no, like, I've asked you about this. You're like, yeah, I have no idea why they just call me that, and there's really nothing behind it. Like, oh, most nicknames have, like, a reason.
The story is, so the story is, legend has it, that when I was born, they brought my brother, who was 16 months in, to visit me, and he could not pronounce Christopher. He kept coming out with Crippa, Crippa, and then that nickname has stuck ever since the day, since the hour I was born.
That makes sense. Like, my youngest, her name is Marion, which was my grandmother's name. But her sister, her older sister, who was very young when she was born, about 16 months, actually, kind of like your brother, give or take, she kept saying May May. And so guess what? You know, she goes by May May probably more often than she goes by Mary. I mean, all her friends at, you know, Mother's Day, all her friends at preschool, they always say it's May May. So, yeah, she's got a little bit of that as well. So, I mean, you know, it just kind of sticks.
Yeah, and what's funny about that is I moved away after high school. I never really came back home until just a couple of years ago. When you ask people back at home, hey, so I ran into Christopher Lionel. Who's Christopher? Who is that?
Christopher.
Crippa. Oh, Crippa. There you go. That him. Oh, I remember.
I've never
Crippa.
Called you Christopher
no,
in
even
my
knows
life.
On my birthday.
You know, that's. I'm sure your parents probably call you Christopher, but I didn't realize it was like. So you went by Christopher more in your hometown than Chris?
I went by Crippa. I never went by my full name. Only my mom calls me Christopher when she's upset with me.
Yeah, I understand. Or maybe your wife. I mean, has she ever, you know, dropped the whole?
She never has. She never has. But when I do hear Christopher, I just know to go hide and go run away.
All right, let's talk football, man. I was surprised last night at the dubious start by the Cajuns. The game was one full of extremes. I was saying that last hour with Gus. But what were your were you as surprised as I was, just based on the last few weeks, at how the Cajuns started that game last night and how quickly they just kind of put themselves in a pretty big hole?
Well, I think to answer that question, I have to kind of go over my commandments of football. And I basically have two, Scott. And I tweeted about this actually earlier in the football game. Someone made a comment, and then I responded to it. And that is, you know, I played this game a long time. I watched it forever after I played. And these two rules have always held true. And that is, number one, you never go for two until 10 minutes to go in the fourth quarter because you just don't know what's going to happen. So much is going to change. You never want to chase points. And the second rule I've always had, I've always held true, is when you get a sudden change, when you get a turnover, and you have an opportunity to take points, and I'm not saying it may be a solid opportunity, but it's an opportunity, whether it's a 40-yard or 50-yard field goal, you take that opportunity because it's a free possession. The opposition is giving you a chance. Here's a freebie. Take points. So I look at early in the football game, you get a sudden change off the first play. That's outstanding. Way to go. Great job. But we talked about it a few weeks ago, Scott. We talked about identity and understanding the kind of team you have at hand. And when you understand that, it helps you kind of orchestrate that team going forward to have success. And I think when it's fourth and three at the 30-yard line, you have a chance to kick a 46-yard field goal with the kicker who's been hot as of late. You're on the road. You're in an environment that you haven't had success since 1989 and against a very stout defense. And listen, I love Mike. I mean, I text Mike every week. You know, I consider Mike a dear friend. I played 4 years with the greatest teammate that I've ever
that I've ever had the privilege to being a part of, whether in any sport. He is the ultimate competitor, and a lot of his lessons that I've learned from him, just not only as an athlete, I've instilled in me as a parent as well. I've got nothing but high praise to speak of Mike, but I still think he's going through a little bit of growing pains as a head coach, which is expected. You expect that out of him, out of a 37-year-old head coach who's never been in this position before. And I think looking back at last night, you want to take that opportunity to get points, to put points on the board, and then you go up 3-0, assuming that Kenny makes the field goal, you go up 3-0 against a very formidable opponent on the road, hostile environment, and then I think the momentum shifts after that. I really do. You go 4-0, you get the sudden change, you put it right back in Southern Miss's hands. You know, eventually they do punt the ball away and they don't score, but I just think things shift after that. So am I surprised? I mean, it's a game of inches, and I think moves can sway suddenly after one play. That's the funny thing about this game. But, you know, I was there back in 2008, Scott. I mean, it was a calamity of errors, and it just felt like we were in quicksand. We could not dig ourselves out of it.
You're talking about the last time that you played.
The last time we played there, absolutely.
Right.
So I was getting a little bit of flashbacks, but I just knew that once we were able to settle down and just play the game that we love, and eventually we did that in the second half, but it was just too late at that point.
Crippa, Chris Lano, our guest, 103.3 The Goat simulcast on 1420. Defensively, in the second half, you only gave up 51 yards. You gave up almost 300 in the first half, and the Wildcat gave him issues, and Frank Gore Jr. throwing it, and you know, not being as disciplined as you needed to be. You're able to get back in the game despite everything because of how you played defensively for most of the second half. But I just look at, and I said it yesterday, if you lose the turnover battle, you're not going to beat Southern Miss, right? You need to let their quarterback make some mistakes. And Wilkie played better than I expected. And I think the Cajuns being in, is it at what point, let me ask you this, Chris, at what point does an offense become predictable because of the scoreboard? You know, it's one thing to be down by a good bit early and you got to make up some ground, right? But when that clock starts working against you in the second half, when you do start mounting a comeback attempt, and look, it's a one possession game and the Cajuns had the ball with 2:05 left. Like, they got back in the game and then a pick six ended it, obviously. But at what point does your offensive play calling become predictable based on the scoreboard?
Well, I think you saw exactly what we were trying to do at the very end of the game. And, you know, I'm sitting there watching the game, and I'm texting a couple buddies of mine, Jerry Abear and Josh Dagno. I mean, Jerry was my equipment manager back when I played, so I've got a pretty good relationship with him. And Josh, who follows the team very closely, I have a lot of respect for him and what he does over with the Rage Review. But, you know, I'm texting them throughout the game, and Josh was a little bit upset at the fact that we were running the football late. And I'm sitting there telling him, look, listen, I mean, I understand your frustration, but one, it's been pretty predictable of what we have been doing as far as throwing the football. But two, we're at a spot now where if you're moving the ball, regardless of how you're doing it, you just got to do it that way. And we were moving the ball forward, trying to punch it into that end zone to go within one score late in the fourth quarter, despite the fact that we were running a lot of clock. But, Scott, the problem is, I mean, you can be predictable as far as sitting in the pocket and throwing the ball down the field, but if you can't block anybody up front, I mean, it doesn't matter. It's irrelevant at that point. And I just saw, if you were to do this, Scott, if you were to take film of each game and you put it in a box, okay, And then I'm sitting in there, you know, after the season, and I haven't watched any UL football all year long. And then I have to go in and watch each game film and predict, okay, which game happened first, which one was second, this happened late in the year. I'm looking at last night and the way the offensive line, the way they were just trying to communicate during blitz pickups and as far as during in between the whistles with twist and, you know, a lot of defensive linemen moving around, they just could not get on the same page. And besides, in a zone blocking scheme, when you're supposed to pass your man off to the next guy to the side of you, you have offensive linemen just chasing one another. And then you're leaving up these big open lanes for linebackers to kind of blitz in and fill those gaps. And Ben just has somebody in the space the entire time. And that was just so disappointing to see. I just thought the offensive line, as well as they played the last couple of weeks, I thought we took a step back last night. And, you know, it's
got to be correct. Let me ask you this, Chris. How much of that do you need to give credit to Southern Miss, who's got a better defense than the previous opponents?
Well, I understand that, but that's just sound football. That's just technique and just being technically sound and understanding just, in the kind of blocking scheme that you have up front. If you're in a zone blocking scheme, you pass the man off. I get that. I understand. And they're very stout. They're a great defensive front. And the numbers didn't lie. I heard Richie talking about it in pregame. You know, it was very similar. It was almost like a mirror image, is the phrase he liked to use, of UL's defense. I mean, as well as we played, and we know how well we played all year long, Southern Miss was right there in the rankings as far as every category with us. But at the same time, you know, you got to find ways to just not allow those open lanes for these linebackers to come through and for defensive linemen to kind of loop around and just get into the back of the quarterback and just create havoc. And it just happened. You saw a lot of inside pressure, and that's where it's very hard for a quarterback to step up and make a throw. And a lot of times I saw a lot of miscommunication along the offensive front. It just, you know, it was hard to watch, but you know, at the same time, despite all the miscues of what happened last night, you still had an opportunity down 8 in the final possession to go in and tie the football game and just try to extend it into overtime. But, you know, it just came up short.
I think with the loss, you know, they're not in the running now to possibly compete for the conference title. I know mathematically it's still alive. That's just, I look at the rest of it, what's in front of them, and I don't think it's happening. You look at the rest of their schedule, Chris. I mean, folks are starting to, you know, look, The team is playing week to week. The fans are looking at the entire season, the rest of the schedule. How do you feel about this team in terms of, you know, maybe final record from this point on and what they got to clean up as they have a little extra time before Senior Day? Now, Senior Day is a week from Saturday for Louisiana. It's not the last home game of the season, but I get it. You don't want to do Senior Day on a Thursday night on a short week and all that. So, they got a little time. Then they have Senior Day a week from Saturday, and then they'll have the home finale 5 days later. And then you end the season. It's just, you know, it's a different kind of schedule this year. So you got Troy, then you're Georgia Southern on a short week, then you're at Florida State and at Texas State to end it. Troy's atop the Sun Belt West right now. They've looked really strong. You know what Georgia Southern brings to the table, and then, you know, you got Florida State and then Texas State. How do you see this season right now today maybe playing out? And what, in your opinion, do the Cajuns have to do to accomplish, you know, where you think they're going to finish?
You know, Scott, it's one thing if you're not able to run the football, and as well as you're not able to throw the football, you're nowhere capable of just moving the ball down the field. That's just really not the case. And defensively, you know, it's not like you're giving up 14, 15 play drives where they're just kind of draining you along the defensive front and just moving the ball down the field. No, this defense, you look at the second half, they gave up 55 or 59, whatever it was, total yards. It was just these big plays that happened early. I mean, it was a first quarter type of football game last night. So I look at this team as a whole. There's really not a whole lot to hang your hat about, you know, despite the fact theoretically you're out of the running along the West. I mean, so we've represented the West the last 4 years. Unfortunately, that is not going to be the case, but there's still a lot to look forward to with the rest of this year. I mean, you're 4-4. You've got 4 games left. You could still easily get bowl eligible, and there's a lot to play for. But you're right, it's a gauntlet now. I mean, Troy, we all know what Troy is going to be like. Georgia Southern, that has always been a chore. You know, for the years when I was calling the games in the booth, that just has never been easy for Louisiana. And you look at Texas State, what they're doing, what they did against App State. I mean, just you can't look by anybody at this point. But the silver lining is you played on a Thursday, so you have a few days to kind of regroup and just regather yourselves. After what happened last night, you played on the road in a short week. You get to go back home. I like the idea of a senior night on a Saturday, even though it may not be your last home game. I appreciate that. I think that's good. But I think you have the right guys in the locker room. It's a veteran-savvy locker room, and I think that's what's good about, you know, if you're going to be in a situation like this, I think you have the right kind of minds, like Chris Moncrief and the Andre Jones, who have been here, you know, since the very beginning, 5 years ago, 4 years ago. And they're going to get these guys back on the right track. I think you have the right group leading you going forward. But there's a lot of football left to play. I'm still excited about it. You know, last night it didn't really work out too well for us at the end. But, you know, it's just the miscues. You know, it's the safety in the end zone. It's the running back touchdown throw that's so easily correctable. You know, when you have a running back in the backfield, the number one goal in mind is to not let anybody get behind you. You know, you got the fumble, which I'd say, Scott, the fumble last night in the opening drive in the second half was just such a dagger. You felt like you had so much momentum going into that football game. So again, it's just a bunch of miscues that can just be corrected, and you know, just you know, you find a way to correct those kind of miscues, and then just you just kind of keep punching along, and you still got four games left. So. You know, it's still exciting. I'm excited about it. I almost went to the game yesterday, almost left work and thought about it. But I'll be there for the home games, and I'm sure a lot of people who are listening are going to do the same.
Last question. Chris Lanaux has been our guest. A single player in your mind that's been the most impressive this season for the Cajuns? Then we'll end on a positive note, and then we'll let you run.
I'll tell you what. Not a whole lot has been talked about this one person. And I want to bring up this one player in particular because I was there in 2018 when he first really started playing. And he had a drop last night, unfortunately. But if you were to look back from 2018 when Billy first got here till now, I think your most improved player in this entire unit would probably have to be Johnny Lumpkin. And I'll say that with this. When Johnny came in and started playing back in 18, he was more of just a blocking tight end. He was absolutely zero threat to you down the field as a receiving tight end. And he's become that formidable receiving tight end for us for the most part of this season. And I know Ben took a shot with him on a fourth down call in the end zone. I mean, he's capable of that. So I give a lot of credit to Johnny Lumpkin, the way he's kind of flourished and the way he's developed over the years. That's a lot of hard work that he's put into. So I just wanted to give him his due. I think he deserves that. On the defensive side of the football, I mean, this guy has probably, I guess you can make the case, he's been overshadowed by great players the last couple of years in Lorenzo McCaskill and Farrar Garner. But Jordan Quibido, I mean, how about him? I mean, finally he gets his time to shine.
Yeah, he's been tremendous.
He finally gets this opportunity to be the guy, the man, that Mike linebacker in the middle. And he's a phenomenal player. Now, I think he could be up there with all conference honors when it's all said and done. And it's just somebody that I didn't expect to excel at this point in his career. And just good for him. He's worked hard. You know, he's waited in the wings for this long, and I couldn't be more happy for him.
Chris Lanaux has been our guest. Crippa, we appreciate the time, man. Have a great weekend. Oh, I said I was going to ask you this. We're done with the Cajuns, by the way.
I was waiting on it.
I know you used to live in Houston. I know you're an Astros fan. You know I'm not, but I'm not rooting against them in this World Series. I'm rooting against the Phillies. I don't know if you heard my little rant at the end of last year. I won't even call it a rant. My take on sort of the Astros and the perception of them. I really don't think you care about the perception. You just enjoy the winning. But how juiced do you think? Maybe juiced is the wrong word. I'm sorry. How excited are you? And I know you're not in Houston anymore. But how excited do you think? Excited do you think everyone is right now? What's the pulse of the Astros fan base? Because you live in that world. I don't.
Well, I did live in that world, and newsflash for you, Scott, I am not an Astros fan. I am not at all.
Wait a minute. What? I've seen you talk about going to games. I've seen you in the gym.
I'm in the corner of your guy, Gus, because growing up my entire life, I was a diehard Cubs fan.
So you were
you were
a bandwagon Astros fan a few years ago.
No, listen, when they moved to the AL – that was different for me. And then I decided to be a part of the camaraderie at that time. They were no longer a threat to my Cubbies. I enjoyed going to the games. I went to Game 7 of the World Series. Unfortunately, we lost that game against the Nationals, but that was a great experience with my wife and I when we got to attend that. But honestly, Scott, I mean, listen, you back in the 90s, and especially 98, that was a great year for me. Mickey Morandini, Lance Johnson, Tyler Houston, Sammy Sosa, Steve Trasel, Kevin Tapney. I can name drop all day for you. But my favorite player growing up, the one guy in baseball, now I was a big baseball guy growing up, but the one guy I tried to emulate as far as my play when it came to hitting was Mark Grace.
I knew you were going to say it.
The open. Now, I was not a left-hander. Okay, I was a right-hander. But watching Mark Grace, the way he was so calm, cool, and collected and had an open stance, and I felt like he was able to put two eyes on the baseball with better vision, I tried to emulate that. And to me, that was my favorite player growing up. And, you know, I really appreciate his play. And also just, you know, when he went to the Arizona Diamondbacks, I was happy for him when he finally won a World Series. But I was a Cubs guy. I was a diehard Cubs. I can name drop all day for you of all the Cubs teams. But when the Kenny Lofton, Aramis Ramirez trade happened in 2003, I was overly ecstatic. That was big time. But I got to tell you something. When they won the World Series back in, I think it was in 16, a big part of me died with that, because that lovable loser syndrome, that was a real thing, and that kind of went away for me. I no longer got to embrace that. Now it's just like, okay, Cubs won, you know, that's great. You know, I'm no longer a lovable loser. I can't embrace this.
We learned that Chris kind of likes being a loser. That's what we just learned.
You said it, brother.
Not me. You said it.
Isn't that the truth? Huh?
I see, that shows you how much I know. I mean, just based on, like, you talking about the Astros, I just assumed you were a big Astros fan. I didn't know the Cubs were a thing. I'll say this. I never had anything against the Cubs. Andre Dawson, loved that guy when I was young.
Loved him.
I mean, that swing. King Griffey Jr. had the best swing when I was a kid, but just behind him was Andre Dawson. And it was a little different, but the man was – he's a legend, man. He's a legend.
He's a legend. And one of my great experiences when I went to Wrigley back in 2005, I think it was, I got to watch Mark Pryor, and he threw an 8-inning gem. And that was against the White Sox, it was. We went to back-to-back games that year. It was the White Sox, and then it was the Astros. And who played in the World Series that season? White Sox and Astros. So I got to watch both of those teams play that same year. That was pretty neat. That was pretty cool. But, you know, I've had some great memories being a big Cubs fan. And I still root for them, but not as heavy as I used to be growing up as a kid.
You just needed to be a loser to root for them, apparently.
I know. Harry Carey, though, those were the days listening in.
All right, man. Go Pelicans. I'll talk to you later. Oh, yeah, you texted me the other night, and I knew that it had to be about the Pelicans game, so I didn't look at it.
So you didn't look at it.
I knew. I just knew based on – because I got to watch the first quarter against the Mavs, and then it was just – you know, I had some dad duties and family stuff, and by the time I was able to, like, turn it back on, it was like – I had already got – I was like, oh, something just happened. Chris is either – texted me something bad or good. I'm not going to look at it. And then I finally looked at it after the game, and I was like, you know what? That was a fitting text. Yes, exhale, because what happened.
But if you ever come in for a game, please let me know. I'd love to buy a ticket to sit with you, if possible.
Yeah, brother. Let's do it, man. I appreciate it. Crip, all the best, and I'll talk to you down the line.
Thank you, Scotty. Appreciate it, bud.
You got it. We're going to take a quick timeout. We'll come back, open up phone lines, plus Michael Desormeaux, what did he have to say after last night's game? Put a lot of the onus on him and the coaches. You'll hear it from him next, right here on The Great Scott Show, 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Thirsty for intelligent sports talk? Sounds like you need a little Gatorade. 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Oh, what are you saying?
All you Trekkies and TV addicts, don't mean to this, don't mean to bring static. All you Klingons in your grandma's house, grab your backstreet friend and get loud. Blowing doors off hinges, grab me with the pinches. And no, I didn't retire, I snatch you off with the needle nose pliers.
Black kids will overhaul, what do you want to ever see? mean, you know what gets paid. Like a place with basil. That could be like Darren, I hate so. I'm a poor partner, get nice with facts. Running, let you know, all right. Now, we ain't call no alarm, cause my farm ain't fast. So what's up with that?
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday. Bottom of the hour. Got an email here from Dawson. Scott, how dare you compliment the Astros? We all know they're nothing but a bunch of filthy cheaters. The Astros are probably still cheating. What's to say they're not? I can't stand them. P.S. Go Yankees. There it is. There it is. You just needed the end of it. Thank you, Dawson. Yeah, they cheated. I don't know. I don't think they're cheating anymore. I guess they could be. Sure, everyone could be cheating. Who knows? I know they're dominant. I know the Phillies also kind of, they feel like a team of destiny right now. Something's got to give. The Fall Classic begins tonight. Tonight. Matter of fact, let's go ahead and throw up a poll on Twitter. Who you got in the World Series? Phillies or Astros? I'm going to put this one up. Go vote for it. At 1033 the GOAT. Let us know. We've got, sorry, I'm doing this as I'm talking on the radio. But Dawson got me motivated, you know, motivated me to throw this poll up there. Who you got? Go vote, sound off, let us know. Jerry emails, he says, Scott, I see there is a London game this week. Where can I find it? It seems like it's always somewhere else. Actually, Jerry, there's not a London game this. Well, is it in London? Maybe there is a London game. I know that there's a game in Germany. I know the Broncos and Jags are playing. What's the Jaguars? Of course, it's got to be London. It's the Bucks who I didn't watch the game last night, but apparently Tom Brady looked really bad. It's the Bucks who have to play the Seahawks in Germany later this season. But yeah, the London game, that is going to be available on ESPN Plus. Which is only streaming. Last night, Thursday night football, only streaming. It had to be Amazon Sunday morning. Now, I don't know why anyone would want to spend a Sunday morning watching Nathaniel Hackett-coached Broncos take on the Jacksonville Jaguars. I mean, Jacksonville kind of feels like the London team a lot of times anyway. They do play better there. But yeah, that one's at 8:30 on ESPN Plus. You know, a lot of Cajun football games are on ESPN+. A lot of Sun Belt games. A lot of games in multiple sports. Last night it was on ESPN2. Cajuns fell to Southern Miss. We've talked a lot about it this morning. Now we've got Coach Michael Desimo. He talked to the media following last night's game, answering some questions, and you know, he got into a few specifics, but I thought overall the message was pretty clear. Here's Coach after last night's loss.
Look, coming in.
Yeah, you know, I mean, that was the thing. They made some big plays early and got us behind a little bit. And offensively, you know, we made some big plays down the stretch, but, you know, turnovers, you know, we've talked about it 100 times. You can't turn the ball over against a good team and expect to win. So, you know, it makes you sick for our players because, you know, as the head coach, it's your job to manage these turnarounds and things like that. And certainly the turnovers and some of the big plays early, I obviously didn't do a very good job of having us ready to go at the beginning. The thing I'll say about this, though, is that team that we have on our sideline, the entire game, they were in it. They were pulling for each other. They've got no quit in them. And, you know, we have a special group of kids, and, you know, it makes you sick when it kind of goes like that because you just feel like if we start a little faster, you know, you can have a different game.
Did you feel like early on that I know you guys tried as hard as you could to kind of keep that fatigue away, but was there just a little bit of fatigue maybe early on, you think?
No, I don't know. I don't know. You know, I felt like coming out, I felt like we were ready to play early, truthfully. I felt like we were in a good spot, you know, warm-ups, all that stuff, just kind of the way the week went. We prepared really well, just kind of came out and just gave up some big ones early, and on offense, you know, really turned it over early. And it just ended up being too much to come back from in the end. I felt like we were in a good spot, but certainly we're going to have to go back and look at things because we have another five-day turnaround coming up here in a couple weeks. So we got to work on some things and find a way to get better at this process. Every team is different, you know, and we did it pretty much the way that we've done it in the past. We did a little more ball security than we did in the past, even though it doesn't look like it. But, you know, every team's different, and we got to figure out what works better for this team.
You get a turnover right off the bat, and then you end up going for it on fourth. Was the process thinking, hey, we just got a turnover, we got them on their heels a little bit, let's take advantage of this, let's be aggressive in this moment?
Yeah, it was. You know, I felt like in this game, you know, I certainly didn't see it going this way score-wise and things like that. I did feel like we'd better run the ball a little bit more effectively early than we did. And they had a good plan for us, and they made some good plays. But, yeah, I felt like we'd get the turnover, plus side of the field, don't waste the opportunity to try to go for it, had a play that we felt good about, and obviously just, didn't get it done right there. And the way I felt like this game would go, felt like defensively we'd be able to get some stops right there. And really defensively we did, you know, other than a couple of big plays that kind of they made and kind of ran with. So, you know, it's one of those deals. You just felt like in the moment, man, we could capture it. We could get this fourth down, and we'd be in really good shape to go down there and take the lead and get off to a fast start. But certainly not the way it happened.
What gave y'all? It seemed like eventually by the end of the third quarter, fourth quarter, you started stopping their running game, but y'all were struggling more than y'all normally do stopping the running game. What did they do so well, man?
Well, I thought their offensive line played really well. You know, that they came off the football. And I mean, you have to give these guys credit now. I mean, they came out and they played really well. The Wildcat stuff's a little different, you know, when you play that much Wildcat, because it's really, you know, they've got an extra person, you know, essentially when you run Wildcat, because everybody's blocking for the quarterback runs. So, you know, they gave us some trouble with that. We made some adjustments at halftime, and I thought, you know, Coach Morgan did a good job with it. Our players, you know, we won a lot of one-on-ones in the second half. We were getting off the blocks. Where early on, you know, we're getting covered up a little bit, and their back's a really good player. You know, we knew that going into it. I thought he was really patient. He was physical when he finished runs. And, you know, there weren't a lot of knockback tackles. You know, it was falling forward, especially early. And those are things that, you know, those dirty yards, the two or three extra dirty yards, it adds up, you know, as you go through it. So, you know, I think our coaches and our players did a good job making some adjustments at halftime and executing better at halftime. But like I said, it was just a little bit too much early.
They were able to get pressure and make Ben get out of the pocket and kind of collapse the pocket sooner than for the play to develop. Was that something that you anticipated their front seven being able to do that?
Yeah, they've got a good pass rush package. And we knew that if it got into, you know, we felt like our third down plan was good. We had some ways to protect it to help with some chips and things like that. But when you get in that many 2-minute situations, you got a lot of one-on-ones, and they did a good job. You know, I mean, they put a bunch of pass rushers on the field, and those guys are pretty relentless, you know, and they've got good pass rushers. Those guys play well. And on the back end, you know, they did a pretty good job whenever they needed to, you know, when they played some zone at the end, let the pass rushers tee off, or we had to hold it a little bit. And you know, that's hard whenever you have good pass rushers in that snip situation.
Did you feel like Ben early on, how did he respond with just kind of that pressure? Did you feel like he handled that well?
I mean, yeah, for the most part, you know, I mean, he doesn't really get rattled. He keeps his composure in there, and he just keeps playing and just keeps going, plugging away at it. You know, I mean, there's things like we talk about it every game that, you know, he'd like to have back, you know, and all those things. But yeah, I mean, for the most part, he handled it well. You know, we get back to the side. We talked about what's happening protection-wise, how we can fix it, how we can get it picked up. But yeah, I mean, he did, you know, he handled it pretty well. You know, it's you have a night like that, you know, where you turn it over and you have some of those things that happen. You know, it's just, you're never completely happy with anything that happened there, right? You know, I mean, there are good spots and everything, but it's got to be more consistent from the start, you know, all the way across the board. And, That's what we're going to do. We'll get back to it. We'll work on it, and we'll do it better next week.
Their freshman quarterback, y'all tried to put pressure on him at times, but he played better than handling that pressure and getting some big third down throws, I thought. I mean, from what I've heard that he had done so far this year, he played a little better.
I thought the kid played really well, man. He made some big throws for him. You know, whenever you have a freshman who goes out there and plays like that, you know, tells you he's going to be something. I thought the kid was tough. Stood in there. He took some hits. He made some big throws. You know, there were some third down plays that he made that were in the pocket throws that were contested catches. Great throw, great catch. He made good decisions on the RPO stuff. And their receiver number one is pretty special too, you know. So they're going to win some like that. And they had way more explosive plays than they normally do. And I think, you know, some of it, they played a little bit better in those spots. Some of it, you know, we probably got to play a little better in some of those spots. But, you know, we're going to get back, you know, we'll get back in the film and we're going to fix the things we got to fix. And, you know, we still got some left that we're going to go out there and we're going to go try to finish this thing the right way. So, you know, tonight, man, is just tough because you felt like you were kind of building on some momentum. And tonight you came out and really early on, man, just kind of snowballed on you. So got to find a way to start faster, and we've got to do a better job protecting the football and eliminating big plays. You know, a lot of stuff that you got to get fixed. So we got a lot of work to do.
That is Coach Michael Decimo following last night's game. Louisiana loses to Southern Miss 39-24. Southern Miss, a late pick six. Biggest stats, 4 turnovers for the Cajuns, 0-5 on fourth down, and some special teams issues. And, you know, gave up just a few big plays early, locked it down defensively in the second half. Michael Jefferson was good, but ultimately Southern Miss wins it by 15. The NFL Sunday schedule isn't all that great. Now, I'm interested in Saints Raiders. It also is one of my children's birthdays, so I'll probably end up watching the game a little bit on delay. I'll be following it. But, you know, I'm only interested in the Saints Raiders because it's the Saints. You know what I mean? I mean, if you're not a Saints or Raiders fan, that one just looks like one of the many stinkers on the schedule this weekend. Who would have thought that in week 8 of the NFL season, the only game on the schedule involving 2 teams with both having winning records. Only one game has teams both with winning records facing off against each other this weekend. Who would have thought that it would be the Giants at Seattle? I mean, who saw that coming? Honestly. That's it. Chiefs and Chargers both have a bye this week. You get the Bengals and Browns on Monday Night Football. Packers at Bills Sunday night. Packers aren't very good. You get a stinker of a London game early on ESPN+. A big old slate of noon games, and, you know, the fans of the teams involved are interested. You got Atlanta and Carolina playing one another. They both have losing records, and the winner will be in first place in the NFC South. Eesh. But on the college gridiron, look, UL isn't playing tomorrow. LSU isn't playing tomorrow. So if you're just saying, man, there's what game should – now, you got some choices. You got a nice spread. You got some fun games, some notable games, interesting games for various reasons. I'll tell you all about it next right here on the Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday.
Gimme all you got! Gimme all you got!
On 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
So let
103.3 The GOAT.
In case you're wondering if Jameis Winston knows his body.
Everything about your body, you have to be able to work certain things. Just because my knee hurting, that doesn't mean that I need to work my knee.
The greatest sports talk of all time. 103.3 The GOAT.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday. We've hit on the Saints, the Pels, UL Southern Miss, World Series, NFL schedule, college football. UL's not playing. They played last night. LSU's on a bye. They're prepping for Alabama next week. That'll be fun. But you've got some fun games. I mean, for starters, Ohio State at Penn State at 11 a.m. For a team that's, you know, number 13 in the country and hosting the game, Penn State is a 15.5 point underdog. 15.5. But Ohio State hasn't been challenged this year. You can go back to week one. Well, they only beat Notre Dame 21. Yeah. And then Notre Dame lost the next week. And I was like, maybe Ohio State isn't that good. Ohio State is just running over everyone. 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 CJ Stroud's been incredible. I mean, it doesn't feel like anything's stopping them from being undefeated heading into the last game of the regular season against Michigan. But this matchup, I mean, Ohio State is averaging 50 points a game. Can Penn State make it something? If they do, I'll be interested. TCU at West Virginia. Horned Frogs feel like they got an outside shot right now at the college football playoff if they keep winning. That one is a fun one. Oklahoma State at Kansas State. A couple of ranked teams in the Big 12. Oklahoma State saying, hey, we're kind of like TCU here. Well, no, you're not, because you lost to TCU. I don't think you got a shot, but they feel like they might have an outside shot if they run the table. I don't, but Kansas State's ranked. They've had a good season. Florida at Georgia. We'll be airing that one for you on our airwaves, 103.3 The GOAT, as well as on the 103.3 The GOAT app. Georgia is a heavy favorite in this one. A heavy 22.5. What's interesting to me is it's Georgia-Florida. They play every year in Jacksonville, the largest cocktail party, or I guess they stopped calling it that like 15 years ago because so many folks are sensitive about, for some reason, saying that people might drink at a college football game. Okay. Georgia takes on Tennessee next week. Florida is not playing the best ball right now. Now, typically, Georgia wouldn't overlook Florida, but would Tennessee maybe look ahead as well? See, Tennessee is hosting Kentucky. They played Tennessee Martin last week. That's one thing. That's a good game to play after your biggest win of the 21st century, which the Volunteers had when they beat Bama. But Kentucky, an odd team that is had some big wins and bad losses. I mean, Tennessee's an 11.5 point favorite. This one is my dark horse upset. I am anticipating a close game. Not because Kentucky's better than Tennessee. They're not. But the positioning of where this game lands on the schedule. Those are some fun ones. Those are some fun ones. Michigan State, I don't know. I mean, I think Michigan's probably going to win. It's in Ann Arbor. Michigan State isn't all that great. But the fact that it is a kind of a semi-rivalry, Michigan thinks more about Ohio State than they do about Michigan State. Yet Michigan State has handled Michigan quite a bit in the last decade. I don't think they're handling them tomorrow. But, you know, they're coming in arguably the most disappointing team in college football. They've lost 3 of 4. They barely beat Wisconsin. Michigan State got blown out by Minnesota. They lost two touchdowns at Maryland. You look at Michigan State and they're saying, okay, we've had a really disappointing season. You know what could make up for all of that? All of it? Ruining Michigan's season. They've been some crazy finishes in that matchup in the past. There are a lot of fun college football games, juicy matchups on paper. Should be a fun Saturday in the world of college football. Should be a fun Saturday. You know, in the Sun Belt, you've got
what, App State's out of conference. They're playing Robert Morris. But Georgia State hosting Old Dominion. Marshall hosting Coastal Carolina. That's on the NFL Network. Arkansas State and South Alabama. Are any of these jumping off the sheet at you? Like, man, this is a big one. And may not be paying attention to them, but the rest of the slate of college football just across the board has me more interested than in some of the Sun Belt games this weekend. Now, the following week, you get to November 5th. You got a lot of big games as far as Sun Belt conference play goes. Then you got a lot of big games nationally, and LSU's playing Bama at night, and Georgia's playing Tennessee. As fun as tomorrow's college football slate is, it's really just an appetizer to the main course a week from tomorrow. That's going to do it for me on a Give Me All You Got Friday. Thanks to Gus Kattengell. Thanks to Chris Lanaux. Thanks to all of you for listening, to the emailers, tweeters. Appreciate it. Go vote in our poll. Who's winning the World Series? Who you got, Astros or Phillies? It's over on our Twitter feed. Right now? Yeah, not a surprise. A lot of you are feeling the Astros. 87.5% of the vote so far. Phillies got 12.5%. I'll talk to you guys Monday. Have a great weekend. It's 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.